This is a CHEM Study film, a production of the Chemical Education Material Study.
We've called this special seminar to report to you something everyone was talking about at the American Chemical Society meeting several of us just returned from. At least two stable crystalline solids, compounds of the inert gas xenon, have been prepared. One of them was reported by Bartlett of the University of British Columbia several months ago, and the new one is xenon tetrafluoride.
Research is an exciting activity. We want to share some of this excitement with you in terms of the discovery you've just heard about, the first synthesis of compounds of the inert gases. To appreciate this discovery, you must realize that for decades, chemists had regarded these elements as totally without chemical reactivity. Oh, a few chemists expected some sort of compound formation, but all attempts to synthesize compounds were without success. Consequently, when the first announcement was made of compounds of xenon, first with platinum and fluorine, then xenon tetrafluoride, chemists greeted the news with skepticism, amazement, and intense excitement. The preparation turned out to be surprisingly simple. It probably wasn't discovered earlier because of the difficulty of handling fluorine. Xenon and fluorine are passed through these two flow meters, and then a mixing chamber. The gas mixture enters a nickel tube, which is heated to 400 degrees centigrade in a furnace. Xenon tetrafluoride condenses in a dry ice trap. Let me show you a sample of xenon tetrafluoride. Occasionally, a sample of xenon tetrafluoride will explode, but usually it can be stored, provided it's kept perfectly dry. Xenon tetrafluoride is extremely reactive. For example, it reacts with water. The yellow color that is developing is presumably due to an intermediate in the formation of XeO3. When the reaction is complete, an aqueous solution of the xenon trioxide remains. On evaporation of the water, white crystals of the very explosive XeO3 are left. Let's take a small bit of this oxide on the tip of a spatula and see what happens when it is touched with a piece of paper tissue. This reactivity of the compounds of xenon is, of course, closely connected with the special stability of the element itself, the stability that caused chemists to classify xenon as an inert gas. Nevertheless, the mere existence of these compounds has great impact on our knowledge of chemical bonding. Many scientists immediately began research, studying the properties of the xenon compounds and attempting to prepare others. This is what makes chemistry so exciting. We're going to try to show this by following an actual research problem, the preparation of an inert gas compound. Maybe you'll be able to see how research starts, how it proceeds, and why it's so very challenging. The research you'll observe was performed by Dr. James Turner, a young visiting scientist from Cambridge University, England. We went to work shortly after we'd heard that xenon tetrafluoride had been prepared for the very first time.
I measured this spectrum, which is supposedly pure xenon tetrafluoride, and we ought to have, from what we know in the literature, one absorption here and one somewhere about here. Whereas actually we have this lopsided absorption here, and this one here. Now this indicates to me that we have not got pure xenon tetrafluoride. Conceivably, we could have xenon difluoride or possibly oxygen impurities. And when I did the experiment again, I got this spectrum. And you'll notice that we have more bands than with the first sample.
Was the second experiment done under similar conditions to the first?
Yes, except that possibly there's a little more sample on the window here than here.
Well, what experiment do you expect to do next?
Well, I was thinking of adding some oxygen to the sample. And then, if oxygen reacts with xenon tetrafluoride, conceivably the products could be responsible for some of these bands. And then we should see those bands increase in intensity. Mm-hmm. Another thing I might do would be to change the method of preparation of XEF4. Say, change the furnace temperature or possibly the xenon to fluorine ratio. And then see what the spectrum of the new sample looks like.
Yes, that's the right way to proceed. But before you go ahead, let me propose another experiment that may be more crucial, and if we were successful, would be a truly significant step ahead. Wouldn't we like to know whether other inert gases form such compounds? So I propose that we try to make the krypton analog of xenon tetrafluoride. Now this compound, if it exists at all, may be less stable than the xenon compound. For one reason, krypton has a higher ionization energy than xenon. So I suggest that a low temperature technique may be best. Suppose that we were to suspend fluorine in solid krypton at, say, 20 degrees Kelvin, using liquid hydrogen as a coolant. Then we decompose the fluorine with ultraviolet light so that we can cause the reaction to occur at this low temperature. Now, even if krypton tetrafluoride is unstable at room temperature, if we form it at 20 degrees Kelvin, we'll be able to preserve it, get its infrared spectrum, and identify it. Now, if we were able to show that krypton forms a tetrafluoride as well as xenon, that would be very important. We'd have a basis for testing our ideas of the bonding in these compounds.
You know, that sounds like a splendid idea. You mean, start with fluorine, dissociate it with light to break up the bond in the fluorine molecule to give fluorine atoms, and then these fluorine atoms will react with krypton to give krypton tetrafluoride, or possibly krypton difluoride. But, you know, we're going to have to think of some way of being quite sure that we've got krypton tetrafluoride. Let's see. I know. Start with xenon rather than krypton. In other words, put fluorine in solid xenon at 20 degrees, fertilize it with light to see if we get xenon tetrafluoride. We know xenon tetrafluoride exists.
I get your idea. We try it first with xenon, same technique, find the best conditions and then go on to krypton.
That is one problem though, you know. That is that fluorine is so very reactive and dangerous that we're going to have to modify the apparatus.
Yes, we can't have glass.
No. Take an all-metal system. If we use copper, though, we shall get a protective coating of the fluoride. Let's see. We have our cold cell somewhat like this. A copper block at the bottom. And then the cesium iodide window here. The thermocouples in here.
This is the interior of one of our cold cells. The window is a crystal of cesium iodide selected because of its transparency to infrared light. It is cooled by this copper block, which forms the bottom of a container for liquid hydrogen. The krypton and fluorine gas mixture will be sprayed onto this cold window and frozen at 20 degrees Kelvin. Then the sample, still cold, will be irradiated with ultraviolet light. Any krypton tetrafluoride formed would remain here in the solid. Then the infrared spectrum can be recorded with light passing through the sample and the window. These wires are connected to thermocouples with which we measure the temperature. The entire cell is enclosed in a vacuum container for thermal insulation.
Jim has now transferred hydrogen into the cold cell. The cold gas is causing this moisture condensation. Jim has modified the cell, he has performed successful experiments with xenon, and is now starting the first experiment with the fluorine-krypton mixture. As soon as the cell window is cold, the fluorine-krypton sample can be deposited.
Can you turn the helium pressure up just a little, do you think? That's better. This is taking a very long time, isn't it?
Suppose we're out of hydrogen?
That's a possibility. What did you say the reading was?
It's approaching 20 degrees.
Cells full of hydrogen now.
The temperature's still dropping. Now it's steady. That's 20 degrees Kelvin.
Good. Would you mind turning off the helium, please?
Off?
Right. I'll just take this out and then we can start spray on.
Would you like to watch the sample deposit as I turn the needle valve?
Okay, I'm set.
I'll start with just 3/4 of a turn.
No deposit yet.
All right.
I'll open it just a little bit more.
Here it comes. It's depositing now.
The sample is forming a white spot in the center of the window. It looks a bit snowy. Now the color's changing on the right side. It's changing to blue. Jim, come take a look.
I see a violet spot developing just at the edge of the window. Spreading out now. Oh, now it's turning to blue. It's very pretty. The rings are spreading out just a little bit more all over the window. Oh, now the spot's changed to green. It's really very beautiful. The rings are now spreading right over the whole of the window. Yes, the sample seems to be depositing just about right.
Temperature is holding constant. 20 degrees Kelvin. About how long will the spray-on take with this valve setting?
About 5 hours.
These experiments are prolonged and require constant attention. Many of them last as long as 10 or 12 hours. Throughout the experiment, the sample must be held at 20 degrees Kelvin. For photolysis, the cell is moved. The light from an intense mercury arc is used to photolyze the fluorine. This step will take another 2 hours. The photolysis is complete. Now we shall see if the experiment is a success. We are moving the cold cell into place in an infrared spectrometer that will scan the appropriate spectral region.
It's firm.
Good.
All set?
Right. Thank you.
Jim is now beginning the scan.
Nothing yet.
Let's just see where the xenon fluoride bands were. Still
about through the xenon fluoride bands now.
Jim, look here, look here.
What's this?
Isn't that lovely?
Is that tremendous?
What's the frequency there?
580. That's 16 above xenon tetrafluoride and about 35 above xenon difluoride.
That's quite reasonable. The mass of xenon is greater than that of krypton.
Right. But wait a moment, though. We may have oxygen there as an impurity.
Well, you did a fluorine-oxygen experiment, didn't you? Maybe we'd better look at that spectrum. Well, now, these absorptions are missing. That's hopeful.
And notice also that this band here isn't in quite the same place as this one here.
Can you estimate how much oxygen would be needed to give about that much absorption?
Well, that's very difficult to do because it depends so much on what the spray-on conditions are. You know, I'm inclined to think that because of the fact that there's a band here and not here, and also that this one isn't quite in the same position as this one, we have in fact got some krypton fluoride.
Yes, I should say the evidence looks very good. Nevertheless, you may want to add some oxygen to this sample and verify that this cannot be due to oxygen impurity.
Agreed.
This experiment is typical of most research experiments. The result is not quite certain. The evidence that a krypton compound has been made is good. Still, the possibility that oxygen interfered must be eliminated. The evidence that the absorption is due to krypton fluoride must be weighed and evaluated. Alternate explanations must be explored. If a krypton compound has been made, then the significance to our theories of chemical bonding must be considered. Compounds of the inert gases were not totally unexpected. There are many similarities to well-known compounds whose bonding has been a subject of intense study. So these discoveries do not destroy our understanding of chemical bonding, they add to it. Like all scientific theories, our theory of chemical bonding is constantly growing and changing as research adds to our knowledge and understanding.